Mining is not exactly a low-impact activity. It is not sustainable in the technical sense of the word, and it never can be. Once stuff is dug up or extracted, it's never coming back. In the past, it was simple. Mining was bad for the environment, environmentalists opposed mining, and supporters of mining were not environmentalists. But ever since we became aware of climate change a few decades ago, environmentalism didn't only mean protecting local environments, it also meant protecting the global climate. Now, the solution to climate change is well understood. It's an energy transition. We get rid of stuff like coal-fired power plants and petrol cars and replace it with stuff like wind turbines and solar panels and batteries and electric vehicles. But the thing about stuff is, if it can't be grown, it must be mined. At some point in the last few years, the general public realized that wind turbines don't sprout from the field, and neither do batteries, electric vehicles, or transmission lines. All this energy transition stuff will need new mines to provide all the iron, copper, lithium, nickel, etc. to build them. So that's a paradox for your 1990s era environmentalist. Mining is bad for the environment, but to save the environment, we have to mine. In this video, we're going to get serious about mining for the energy transition. The general vibe is that we can clean up mining. It can be zero emissions. Companies are already making moves in that direction, and we're going to find out about the technologies that they're using to achieve that. But we're also going to get real that mining is not and can never be a sustainable activity. I'm Rosie Butts. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Okay, let's get real. Mining means taking something out of the earth to use it somewhere else. You can rehabilitate an old mine site, but it will never be just like it was. This here is an old sapphire mine from the 60s to the early 2000s. And in the 1980s, 10% of the world's sapphires actually came from this really small mine. There has been a lot of effort to rehabilitate it since then, but you can see that it's never going to go back to the way it was. Unfortunately, I think the climate crisis has forced us to grow up a bit since the early days of environmentalism. These days, the local and global environment are sometimes in conflict, and it's better to recognize that than to pretend that sustainable mining is a goal that we can aspire to. So with that in mind, let's head inside to talk about where emissions in mining come from, and then we'll find out what solutions are available for zero emissions mining and to deal with some of the other environmental issues related to mining and check in on progress from the industry towards that goal. About 10% of global CO2 emissions come from digging stuff out of the ground, with over 90% of that from fugitive methane released during coal mining, which we already know we need to stop that. But that's just to extract the materials. Processing minerals and metals contributes almost another 10% to global emissions. And unlike fossil fuels, the demand for minerals and metals will increase during the energy transition. In fact, I've heard a lot of people say that the energy transition is going to need more mining overall than our status quo fossil fuel energy system. You might have seen posts like that in your social media feeds. It is true that on average, an electric car needs 6 times the amount of minerals as a petrol car does, and an onshore wind farm needs 4 times more mineral resources than a coal-fired plant. But making the car or power plant isn't the whole story, is it? The reason we're replacing those technologies is for what comes after the manufacturing. It's the fuels that cause greenhouse gas emissions. And when you factor in mining for those fuels, you get far more mined products needed for fossil fuel technologies than clean ones. And if you include downstream emissions too, fossil fuels are burned, whereas minerals in a battery, for example, get recharged over and over and then can be recycled at their end of life. Let's look at just one example, petrol versus an electric vehicle. Throughout its life, a typical car with an internal combustion engine burns roughly 17,000 litres of petrol. In contrast, the metals in battery cells weigh around 160 kilos, 100 times less. Furthermore, considering the recycling of battery materials and the fact that most of the metal content can be reclaimed, only about 5 to 30 kilos of metals will be lost for the average battery. At most, 1.8 kilos of lithium, 0.4 kilos of cobalt, and 1.4 kilos of nickel, equivalent to the size of a football. In comparison, the weight of petrol or diesel that gets burned during a vehicle's average lifespan is hundreds of times more than that. Even with no recycling of batteries, we're looking at about a 99% reduction in the amount of mining needed for an EV compared to a petrol car. And when you include recycling, it's more like a 99.9% reduction. With this in mind, isn't it unfair to target mining associated with energy transition technologies while ignoring mining for fossil fuels? As we phase out fossil fuels, the emissions from their mining will naturally decrease, so the problem will get smaller. So it is crucial to focus on making mining for essential minerals like iron, copper, and lithium emissions-free, as they are vital for our shift to a zero emissions future. So let's focus our attention there right now. We'll start by taking a look at the common processes in mineral mining and where exactly emissions come from. But just quickly, before we get onto that, I've got something special to share about a new partnership. I've teamed up with Planet Wild, a community fiercely dedicated to reviving our planet. They're on a fascinating mission this month. It's an innovative approach that caught my eye, and I think you'll find it just as intriguing. So wait till the end to find out more about that. The first step in mining is extraction, blasting or digging and then hauling material away to be processed. Emissions from extraction comes from fossil fuels in mining equipment, vehicles and facilities, or in machinery like drills, excavators and transport trucks, plus on-site electricity generation. All of these energy demands have traditionally been met by diesel mostly, but they can be electrified or use hydrogen or biofuels to reduce emissions. Beyond the direct emissions, we also encounter indirect ones from supply chains, such as the production and transport of steel for mining equipment and from off-site electricity generation used in mining operations. As the overall economy shifts towards decarbonisation, these indirect emissions are set to decrease. Land clearing for mining sites introduces another source of emissions. While not actually the largest contributor to global warming potential, open-cut mining in forested areas disrupts ecosystems and leads to biodiversity loss, particularly in countries like Brazil, Indonesia, Peru, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. These nations face deforestation challenges associated with mining for bauxite, nickel, copper, and cobalt. Finding alternative mineral sources not located beneath forests could mitigate this impact, and rehabilitating sites afterwards needs to be funded properly and done with care. Moving on to ore processing, we refine the raw materials into usable metals. This is an exercise in concentration. Most of the mined material is typically stuff that's not valuable to miners, and the concentration of the good stuff can range from around 30 to 65% in the case of iron ore, down to 0.6% or even less for copper. In either case, or anywhere in between, to get to a more pure form of the metal, it needs to be processed. Large rocks get crushed to small particles. These particles get roasted or leached or smelted or a combination of all of those or other chemical reactions. Crushing and grinding stand out as particularly energy-intensive processes. In fact, a staggering 3% of the entire world's electricity is devoted to this task. Smelting is another major consumer of energy, used to extract metals by heating ore beyond the melting points of the desired metals. My previous discussions on zero emissions industrial heat technologies delve into the ways to mitigate these emissions. And it's worth noting that reduction reactions can also generate significant emissions, as explored in my coverage of iron ore reduction. There are other chemical processes used to extract or purify minerals, calcination, leaching, flotation, pyrometallurgy are some examples that are energy intensive or emit greenhouse gases directly. After all that processing, we have a more pure form of the metal. However, we also have a whole lot of waste. Waste management is needed to preserve the local environment, and many waste management practices carry a carbon footprint. For instance, the use of lime to neutralize acidic mine waste is a common practice. While it plays a pivotal role in mitigating local environmental damage, the production of lime itself releases a whole lot of CO2. Additionally, the natural decomposition of carbonate minerals like siderite and calcite found within waste rock and tailings contributes to emissions during processes such as weathering, neutralization, acid leaching, and metallurgical processing. This can be a big one. For example, degradation of carbonate minerals has been estimated to contribute almost 8% to greenhouse gas emissions at BHP Billiton's Olympic Dam copper, uranium, gold, silver mine in South Australia. Lastly, the transportation of mined materials to processing sites or export ports introduces additional emissions, depending on the transportation method. Like the broader transport sector, mining can look towards electrification and alternative fuels like biofuels or hydrogen derivatives for emission reductions. Navigating the path to a sustainable mining future isn't as straightforward as ranking emission sources and applying a one-size-fits-all solution to all mines. The complexity arises because emission sources vary wildly across different minerals. For instance, in iron ore mining, the bulk of emissions stem from loading and hauling, whereas for copper, the primary culprit is the energy-intensive process of crushing and grinding. Furthermore, the mining methods for a single mineral can differ dramatically depending on the location, such as lithium mining from Australian spodumene rocks compared to extraction from South American brines, leading to vastly different emissions profiles. Moreover, even within a single mine, processes and associated emissions can evolve over time due to factors like mine depth and ore grade changes. This dynamic nature of mining operations means there's no one-size-fits-all solution to achieve zero emissions across the board. Given these complexities, a comprehensive overview of zero emission solutions for every conceivable mining scenario is beyond what I can achieve in a YouTube video. Instead, let's zoom in on specific tangible examples from the mining of iron and copper. Those are two minerals with significant total emissions due to their massive global production volumes, and both metals that we need more of for energy transition technologies. Although per kilogram iron and copper's emissions might not compare with those of precious metals like gold, platinum, or palladium, the global scale of iron and copper production makes their overall impact substantial. Fortescue Metals Group, the world's fourth largest iron ore producer, is ambitiously aiming for real zero emissions by 2030. That means no offsets. A notable project was their 2022 Energy Connect initiative, which integrated solar panels, batteries, and high voltage transmission lines to replace the majority of diesel generators across various sites. And for emission sources lacking current commercial solutions, Fortescue has innovated. The Infinity Train, previously discussed on this channel, exemplifies their ambition. This electric train recharges using gravitational potential energy from descending loaded from the mine to the port, eliminating the need for external charging. In the realm of loading and hauling, Fortescue is working on electric machinery, exemplified by their plan to deploy a massive 3-megawatt charger for trials in 2024. Additionally, Fortescue's advancements include the deployment of the world's first green hydrogen-powered haul truck at their Christmas Creek mine, showcasing a tangible step towards their zero-emission goals. Looking beyond their 2030 Scope 1 and 2 emissions targets, Fortescue is exploring green ammonia or methanol for shipping and a low-temperature electrolysis method to produce green steel from iron ore without coal. A pilot of this process was launched in 2023, potentially revolutionizing steel production, which currently accounts for 8% of global emissions. In copper mining, crushing and grinding are the most significant energy demands. Innovative strategies are being employed to reduce emissions there. A recent study highlighted that cutting-edge common use technologies can decrease energy consumption by 40% with enhanced blasting techniques, further reducing the need for energy-intensive crushing. Transitioning to renewable energy sources can then address the remaining emissions from these processes. Antofagasta, a prominent player in the copper industry, has made remarkable strides by achieving a 90% reduction in Scope 2 greenhouse gas emissions since 2021 by transitioning to 100% renewable electricity for its operations and electric trucks and ancillary mining equipment. The company is capitalizing on Chile's abundant and cost-effective renewable energy resources to power its operations. At its Centinela mine, Antofagasta has implemented a solar thermal plant which harnesses solar energy to produce heat and electricity. Solar thermal technology uses mirrors or lenses to concentrate sunlight onto a receiver where it's converted into thermal energy. This energy can then be used directly for industrial processes or to generate electricity, reducing their reliance on fossil fuels. Furthermore, at the Los Pelambres and Zaldivar mines, Antofagasta has introduced innovative conveyor belt systems that contribute to self-generation of electricity. These systems are designed to capture the energy generated during the downhill transport of ore, similar in concept to Fortescue's Infinity Train idea. As the loaded conveyor belts descend, they drive generators that produce electricity, which can then be used to power various operations within the mines. This not only reduces the need for external power sources, but also capitalizes on the potential energy inherent in the mining process. In wrapping up, we're faced with a stark reality. The mining industry, with its checkered environmental past, stands at a crossroads in the face of climate change. The paradox is as clear as it is challenging. The very materials that are pivotal for the renewable technologies driving the energy transition are born of an industry that has been, to put it mildly, less than stellar in its environmental stewardship. This juxtaposition doesn't erase the undeniable benefits of clean energy technologies. As we march towards a future powered by zero emissions technologies, the goal of a near circular economy where recycling takes center stage becomes not just aspirational but necessary. Mining is needed though in this phase of the energy transition while we are building more clean energy technologies than we are retiring and recycling, and while populations are still growing and developing. However, it's imperative to approach the mining sector with a critical eye. The industry's attempts at greenwashing only serve to muddy the waters, reminiscent of the oil and gas sector's half-hearted forays into renewables. But here's the rub. Unlike fossil fuels, which we can and must phase out, the materials mined from the earth are irreplaceable in the machinery of our zero emissions future. We can't simply wish away the need for mining. As we wrap up today's discussion, I want to circle back to something truly close to my heart, Planet Wild. You heard me mention them earlier, and here's why they stand out to me. Planet Wild isn't just another organization, it's a global community, including folks like you and me who are passionate about restoring the natural world. Clean energy technologies like the ones I cover on this channel are going to be how we limit the extent of climate change, but the natural world has already been affected and needs help to recover from impacts, including mining. Every month, Planet Wild embark on missions to protect endangered species, clean our oceans, and reforest our planet. I'm a member, and you can be part of it too. And the best part, you don't need to get your hands dirty to make an impact. By becoming a member, you're helping to fund meaningful projects, watching the impact unfold month by month here on YouTube or through their app. I was particularly moved by their latest mission, in which they're reviving a once diverse Caledonian woodland from its monoculture plantation state, restoring the natural biodiversity and balance it once had. It's this kind of creative thinking that makes Planet Wild's approach so effective. And with over 3,000 members and counting, the collective power is immense. But it's not just about the numbers, it's about being part of a community that sees and feels the impact of your contributions. And you can vote in the app to decide which projects to support next. For as little as $6 a month, which is the cost of a family block of chocolate, you can join this movement. And here's the cherry on top. The first 200 of you to sign up using the code Rosie will get your first month free. You're not just signing up for a service, you're joining a movement that's making the planet livable for future generations. Don't just take my word for it, see for yourself. Scan the QR code on the screen or check the link in the description to learn more about Planet Wild's incredible missions. This is your chance to be part of something bigger, to make a real difference now, not someday in the future. Join Planet Wild and let's protect and restore our beautiful planet together. Thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next video.